It's a Friday. This is not a bitch fest. I just have a whole list of things that caught my attention. And I realized that most of them aren't complaints. So I must be doing something right where I've got a week where I don't have a lot of complaints after dealing with stuff. I got an email from a guy. Very interesting email. A guy said, Steve, the other day you did the video about the guy who was fleeing from police and he threw drugs in the police officer's face and got away. And the police officer said he got injured by the drugs. And you said you were skeptical of how possible that was to actually happen in real life. I found another story where that happened. I think you should take a look at it. And of course, I don't remember ever doing a story like that. So I wrote the guy back and I go, I'm curious, which video are you talking about? And he wrote back and he goes, oh my gosh, you responded to me. I said, yeah, when people ask me a question, or want to point something out to me, I'll respond if it catches my attention. And I go, quite frankly, I don't remember the topic. I go, was this like a video like 7 years ago or what? He goes, no, last week. He goes, now that I think of it, it wasn't you. And it wasn't. But the funny thing is that this actually happens about once every 2 or 3 weeks where somebody sends me an email. And again, these could be construed as complaint emails. So I don't always respond to them. But someone will send me an email and say, Steve, in that video where you talked about this, blah, 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 and it doesn't ring a bell. And now here's the thing. I shoot a lot of videos. I was doing the math the other day. And by the way, every now and then I say I could do the math, but I'm a busy man. And that's actually a modified joke from The Simpsons. But the point is, I shoot 2 videos a day, 365 days a year, and I've been doing that for 3 or 4 years now. I've got thousands of videos I've put up. And I still have almost 2,000 on this channel, on the other channel, my main channel. And so I take a lot of them down, but I'll have occasionally someone will watch a video of mine from 4 years ago and say, hey, Steve, there's this, you know, weird thing you brought up. And they remind me I did a video about it 4 years ago. But quite often they'll raise some topic that I never said. I mean, what are you talking about? And they go, oh, I was talking about somebody else. I did the story, and I will grant you that I headlined it, Why Can't They Stop This?, regarding the bad returns at Lowe's, where somebody goes into Lowe's, buys some stuff, walks out with it, and brings the receipt back into the store, picks the same stuff up, brings the front counter, says, I want to return this. And I said, why can't they stop this? All they got to do is give each receipt a unique identifier and then record when it's been cashed out. And I had people, both ends of the spectrum, some saying, Steve, it is so simple to fix, they just choose not to do it. I had people going, this guy is such an idiot, he doesn't know how receipts work. That's what one guy said. Another guy goes, you don't understand how computers work. He goes, computers can't solve all your problems. He goes, number one, the computers run several hours behind. He goes, so they ran the receipts immediately, it wouldn't work. You know how Lowe's computers run several hours behind? Do they? Why? Because daylight savings and what? Seriously. But I actually had 3 different people in the industry contact me. And I thought this is okay because I specifically asked, why can't they stop this? And the 3 people who were in the industry all said basically the same thing. If they wanted to stop it, they could. They choose not to because it would apparently complicate things just a little bit more. And the cost of those complications over all of their stores isn't worth the small amount of inventory shrink that's caused by this. And he goes, it's a cost-benefit analysis. And all 3 guys said that to different degrees. One guy actually told me which stores he worked for and what store, you know, what store chain he worked for. Big one. And I actually spoke to somebody. Let's just leave it at that. And I am convinced that the guys are telling me the truth about what they did for a living. And all 3 of them said that in the industry, it's easy enough to do. In fact, you could do what some stores do and give the people at the checkouts who do returns magic markers and let them mark the receipt. So you have to walk back and go, I want to return this again. And the receipt's been marked as already returned. But there was and is a potential computer solution to the problem, they just choose not to implement it. Whether it's because their computers run a couple hours behind, I don't know. I have to let you know, I posted a photograph on Facebook yesterday, and it's a screen grab of a chessboard. And on the chessboard, I'm playing white. I have a king, nine queens, a rook, and a bishop, and the king is checkmated. And I posted that photograph and jokingly said, this was harder than it looks. And I had a bunch of people ask me to explain that. And I'm not going to type a whole explanation on Facebook, so I'm going to put it here. But in chess, if your pawn makes it all the way across the board, you can then turn it into any piece you want other than a king. And of course, leaving it as a pawn wouldn't help because pawns can only go that way. And most people choose to promote the pawn to a queen. There are situations where you might not do that, but in this case, you do. So I had a game going, and by the way, I was playing a handheld game on my phone. I was watching TV and doing like three things at once. And occasionally when I'm bored, I'll play a game of chess and just move pieces around. Just I'm goofing around, but I'm not even concentrating. And I was playing a game of chess, and I got myself in a really good position, and my opponent, the computer, offered to resign. It goes, I'd like to resign. And I looked at the board and I realized I still had all eight of my pawns and my queen. And I said, no, you can't resign. Tough it out, you little computer. So I then made a point to not lose any of my pawns. I cleaned up all of the black pieces. And here's the tricky part. You have to be careful not to stalemate your opponent, because once you get too many queens, whether you like it or not, the queens are attacking all over the place. So what I did was I would take all the queens and tuck them in one corner, and I blocked them with a king and a bishop, and I'd get a queen, and I'd bring it down over here, and it forced the black piece to just move back and forth. And you might go, Steve, that sounds really stupid. You're playing against a chess program that's obviously set kind of low, and but the point is, I thought it'd be funny to have a board position that had nine queens on it. Nine. And I had a guy actually go, yeah, Steve, I had one the other day. Look at mine. He had eight. I said, yeah, you got eight. I got nine. You lost something along the way, but I'm just joking. I did the story, and this is a complaint. I did the story the other day about the woman who was arrested in Arizona, I believe, for feeding homeless people. And they have a local ordinance against feeding people. And they have it defined in such a way. It doesn't say feeding homeless people. But it does say you cannot feed people as an act of charity in a public space without getting a permit, that kind of thing. And the headline was, grandmother arrested in Arizona for feeding the homeless. I actually had a guy go, why do you keep mentioning she's a grandmother? Who cares? Really? You don't understand why a headline reads better when it says grandmother arrested versus someone arrested? Okay. I didn't bother explaining to the person why that was. But I also had somebody go, I'm really disappointed in you and the Institute for Justice. You both do this story about a woman being arrested in Arizona because there's a law on the books that you guys don't like, and none of you called the city to ask them what they meant with that law. That's wrong. I wrote back and I said, hey, I'm curious. I said, what's the title of the person at the city whose job it is to explain the rationale behind laws? Who do you call? Because you realize that a law can be passed two different ways. A law can be passed by the constituents, putting something on the ballot and passing it. Do we then call every single person in the city and say, did you vote? Yes. How'd you vote? Yes or no? Oh, you voted yes? What was your rationale? And then do we have to poll all the people who said no and ask them why they voted against it? But if the city council passed it, do we have to call the head of the city council and ask them why they think the other people on the panel voted for it? Or do we have to ask all of them, and again, why'd you vote for this? Oh, you didn't vote for it. Why'd you vote against it? Why do you think your fellow... What? And by the way, you understand that if you ask them why they passed a law, they'd say, it was for the good of the community. What do you think they're going to say? We hate homeless people? I'm so disappointed that you and they, neither of you called. Have you ever seen a news story, ever? And by the way, someone's going to find one now, but have you ever seen a news story where they talk about a law and they ask the legislature as part of the story to simply explain, sorry about the bad edits, I'm having an issue with my throat, it's cold up. And have you ever seen a news story where in the middle of the story they say, oh, by the way, we called the legislature to ask them why they passed this law? And if you find such a story, guess what they're going to say? We did it for the good of the community or the state or the country. Take your pick. So, no, I do not call cities and say, why'd you pass a law? Because I know what they're going to say. And what they say is meaningless. They passed the law. The law speaks for itself, by the way. So why'd they pass the law? Who cares? The law's in the books. It's illegal to feed homeless people in that city in Arizona without a permit. We'll see how long that lasts. Now, I have to also tell you a couple things. And one is, I recently had somebody ask me again about something on the set behind me. I think I've done videos about the stuff behind me, but of course the stuff behind me does, in fact, evolve over time. So I'm now going to tell you briefly about the most asked about things on the set. So just to let you know, beware of low-flying owls. And that's up there, and it's also in the end credits of every video I do. It's up there because of the fact that a while back I did this story about the airplane coming into an airport and it hit a truck on its way in. The airplane pilot sued the truck owner under Michigan's no-fault law, saying that the truck was somehow at fault for that collision. I did a story on that, and as a joke, I ran a picture of a photograph I had taken of a sign like that in Florida. And I said during the story, I couldn't find one of these caution low-flying aircraft sign photos, but I had one of those. And I said, so, you know, beware of low-flying owls. And it became a joke. Somebody sent me one. There you go. You'll notice that there is a Lehto's Law sticker on there. And a viewer printed up 25 Lehto's Law stickers and sent them to me. So now I got all my cars plastered with stickers. The microphones behind me are an homage to my time in radio. I spent a lot of time as a disc jockey prior to law school. After law school, I became a talk show host. When I worked in radio in the early 1980s, I began collecting microphones. I bought that microphone, the Big Shure, the tallest microphone behind me. I bought that at a flea market back in about 1985, and that began my obsession with collecting old microphones. Many people noticed the Lollipop, which is a popular microphone, apparently back in the Citizen Band radio and or ham amateur radio days as well. People often ask me if I am a ham radio operator. No, I am not, but I know people who are. And many people, including somebody the other day, points out that this right here, W8NEC, is the call sign for a gentleman who's no longer with us. And somebody said, did you know he passed away? I said, yes, I did a video on him. They said, oh, okay. But a friend of the show sent me that a while back, and a very, very nice guy, Norman Kreller. And that's plugged in, and it does glow in the dark. It's just you can't see it on camera that well. So I am aware of who he was. He sent that to me. And much of the stuff behind me was sent in by viewers. And I thank everybody. And I can't thank everyone who's sent me stuff, but I do put it out there, and I hope that's enough. I have to let you know the bumper stickers are also a callback to my time in radio. At one point in time, I worked at WABX, which is one of the first FM rock and roll stations in America. One of the first. Great radio station. But it was in Detroit, as was WRAF, WLLZ, and W4. We had four rock and roll stations at one point in time in the late 70s, early 80s. So very, very cool time period. And of course, there's the K-Pig and the K-Fat, other well-known radio stations scattered about the nation and about my set. There's the lawyer dog sign, which is a reference to a story where a man down south told a detective interrogating him, I want a lawyer dog. And they kept questioning him. And so finally he told him something they used against him. And so on appeal, he said, look, I asked for a lawyer. And the Supreme Court of that state said, no, you asked for a lawyer dog. Not being able to hear the comma between lawyer and dog, he's addressing the detective as dog. And everyone knows that. And that's an example of Supreme Court justices being willfully stupid. And so, by the way, people have said, Steve, when you insult the judiciary, aren't you violating the code of conduct says you're not allowed to insult the judiciary? There is actually rules on that. Yeah. And when I call somebody stupid who is stupid, I would argue and say I'm just being truthful here. And if they wanted to, if somebody actually said, Steve, you called these people stupid for what they did, I'd say, well, let's wait until they complain and we'll have that debate, okay? Let's see them actually say, no, we honestly thought he was asking for a lawyer dog. So there's a sign there that says a lawyer dog is available on request. This is a lawyer dog, of course, who is over on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, but he's a very, very distinguished lawyer dog. And of course, we've got the lawyer dog down here who's a Sheltie, which he's a very, very good lawyer dog. And then a bunch of stuff on the set references the military or the armed forces or things like the U.S. Coast Guard and the USS Cole. I've never been in the military. Those things are also sent in by viewers. Many of the license plates behind me were sent in by viewers also, although some are obviously mine or things that I gathered up over time. So the Sisu license plate is a Finnish saying. The Karma is, I'm saying it wrong, but it's a Finnish word for snake. That is the license plate on my Viper, although I've got the real one on my Viper. That one's the backup that they give you if you ask for an extra one. And a bunch of other ones were simply sent in by viewers. And so a lot of the stuff behind me was sent in by viewers, including a vast majority of the t-shirts I wear. So I'll wear a t-shirt one day for some high school in Lincoln, Nebraska. The next day, I'll wear a t-shirt from some little school in South Carolina. And somebody go, wait, you went to school in South Carolina? I live in South Carolina. Well, wait, you didn't ask me that yesterday about Nebraska, did you? So I don't know. It was just that the familiar catches people's attention. But the vast majority of the t-shirts I wear were sent to me by people who just said, oh, here's a shirt, double X, wear it. And I'll wear it as long as it's not political or obscene. And I've had people send me things that are both political and obscene, and I can't wear them on camera. And also, if it's smaller than a double X, I can't wear it either. I'm a husky fellow. What can I tell you? But the t-shirts don't have any hidden meaning or anything like that, and they are not necessarily a reference to anything I've done or places I've been. There are a couple people out there, you know who you are, JP, Kurt, Laura, who send me a lot of shirts, and I greatly appreciate that. But it does cause sometimes for there to be a series of shirts in a row from Colorado, for instance, or the Carolinas, for instance. But that's okay. I do try to mix them up. And I've mentioned before that I've got two garment racks behind the camera over here. Two. They're stuffed with t-shirts. And that's only the t-shirts in my current rotation. I've got big plastic tubs filled with old t-shirts from the early days of the show. So I would bet that I've got close to 1,000 t-shirts right now. I've got about 200 to 250 of them right here in the studio. So I rotate through those as time goes by. I try to mix them up a little bit, but the t-shirts, many of them were sent in by viewers, which I greatly appreciate. But when I wear a t-shirt that references some brew pub in South Dakota, I probably haven't been there. And I apologize for that. I don't want to mislead anybody, but that is the situation there. So I also have to tell you that the $100 bill, which is behind me somewhere, I forgot where I put it on this video. I try to move it every day, but I don't always remember. And for that, I apologize. But I got to let you know, some people do ask because they joined us so recently, they don't know, that several years ago, I was talking about the fact there's a notion going around the internet in some circles that you don't need a driver's license to drive a car in America on the roads. And it's been ruled on by the Supreme Court. And if you ask people what's the Supreme Court ruling, they start spewing gibberish at you or sending you websites. And a Supreme Court citation is literally just a couple numbers, the letters US and a couple more numbers. That's it. So it would be like 9 or 10 characters. And instead, they send you these walls of text with explanations about how 1910 Black's Law Dictionary, interspersed with the federal code, somehow means that the Code of Hammurabi and the Magna Carta, boom, ipso facto. Res ipsa. Now I can point at a license plate for Italian, for my Latin stuff. Now I can point at license plates for my Latin. God. Do you know how depressing it is when you have a good joke and it's like that and you screw it up? Res ipsa. I can now point at license plates for my Latin. See, that would have worked. Be that as it may, I held the $100 bill up on camera and said, I will give this to the first person who gives me a U.S. Supreme Court citation that specifically says you do not need a driver's license to drive a car on the road in America in any state. And I actually laid it out as a contest because YouTube actually requires you to lay the rules of a contest out clearly. Most people don't, but I do. And I started getting people sending me all kinds of things that didn't even qualify. Cases from Pennsylvania, a case out of Chicago. I go, do you have a case from the Supreme Court? What's that? So after about a year of just getting the same stuff over and over and over again, I also started getting threats. People were angry that I was doing it. They thought I was mocking them. Me mocking somebody? You got to be kidding me. I finally took the bill down in that sense, took the rules of the contest down and said the contest has ended. I'm allowed to start a contest. I'm allowed to end the contest. I then started getting people mad because they go, I could have won. I say, well, what do you got? Show me. Then they send me the case from Pennsylvania and the one from Chicago and Black's Law Dictionary, Code of Hammurabi, the Magna Carta, Articles of Confederation. I go, you don't have a Supreme Court case that says that? What's that? So the weird part is I have, within the last week, gotten an email from somebody who said, Steve, how many people won that? Because I understand that you were actually giving the $100 bill away repeatedly. I go, nobody won. What are you talking about? He goes, I heard that instead of announcing the winner, you would simply send the $100 bill to somebody and replace it. No, nobody ever won it. I ended the contest because nobody won. And the guy didn't respond, so I don't think he believes me. But anyways, we've gone long enough for a Friday. So I got to wrap this up, go start editing. Big game on Saturday. Of course, this will date the video, but it's Michigan State, Michigan on Saturday. Under the lights at the big house. Questions or comments, put them below. Otherwise, I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.